Hi, I'm Lysa TerKeurst. Thanks so much for being with us today. This is my good friend and teammate, Shae Tate.
Hi, everybody.
So Shae, we've been working on a project for a pretty long time.
A while.
Where I went into my personal journal and then also some favorite pieces and parts of my past couple of books, It's Not Supposed to Be This Way, and Forgiving What You Can't Forget, and some letters, some very private, personal, straight to the reader's heart letters that I've written. And we've put them all in a new devotional called Seeing Beautiful Again.
Yes.
So I'm really excited about this project. And so Shae, I knew you had some questions that you wanted to ask me, and I think you'll enjoy this discussion.
Yeah, so I just wanted to sit with you today and ask you some questions that I would love to know, or I think our friends at home would love to know, since this devotion really is like a personal extension out of your own journal. And so I know we just said the title, but it's called Seeing Beautiful Again. So how did you decide on this title, and what does that phrase, Seeing Beautiful Again, mean to you?
Such a good question. So in 2019, my word for the year was beautiful. And I really wanted to take a look at being more intentional with finding beauty, seeing beauty, choosing a beautiful perspective, and creating beauty for friends and family. And so that word became such a filter through which I looked at life. And I did it because I usually like to choose a word for the year, and that one just seemed appropriate for that year. But what happened is I noticed the more beautiful things I looked for, the more beautiful perspectives I desired to see, the more beauty that it felt like was all around me. And I thought to myself, it's not because my circumstances have changed. It's not because suddenly people all around me were, you know, just acting in perfect ways. It wasn't that all of my relationships suddenly just became amazingly beautiful. And it was the intentionality of wanting to find beauty, and when you look for it, you start to see it. It reminds me of that verse in Matthew chapter 5, verse 8, that says, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." It doesn't mean blessed is that perfect person. It means blessed is that person who desires to see God, for then they certainly will. And it's not that we see God's physical form, but we start to see evidence of God's faithfulness in more clear ways.
Yeah.
And that's really what happened with Beautiful. I just started to see it more clearly than ever before. And I thought more people need to learn how to see beautiful again.
Yeah, I love that. And I love how you already said what I was going to say is that seeing beautiful, a prerequisite for seeing beautiful is not that your circumstances are perfect or that your life is tidy, but just that there's intentionality around what you're looking for. So I love that. That's so good. Okay, so one of the promises you have for us as readers in this new devotional is that we will gain healthier ways to process our pain and learn to see our situations through truth-based perspectives. I love that. So what are one of those truth-based perspectives maybe that you've been clinging to or that has been the most helpful to you maybe recently?
Well, in the book I wrote, one of the devotions was about being at a speaking engagement, and one of the questions I got during the Q&A portion was this gal raised her hand and just said, "Why is God doing nothing?" She was in a really hard circumstance, and I very much related to the angst of her question. And so I don't even know where the answer came from, except I think I naturally just have gone through so many hard things that I've naturally trained my brain to remember, even when it seems that God is doing nothing, to remember we don't serve a do-nothing God. God is always working behind the scenes, and sometimes we have to remember God does his best work sometimes in the unseen. And so there's always going to be gaps in our life where we don't really understand what's happening. And I am training my brain not to fill in the gaps, instead of filling in the gaps and making assumptions about what God is or is not doing. I let the gaps sit there, and I see that as a space for grace where I need to invite God in. God isn't trying to be far off, distant, and mysterious. He doesn't want to be explained away. God wants to be invited in. So when there's gaps in understanding, or there's a day where I think, where are you, God?
Right.
Why aren't you doing something about this? You promised to be there for me, but I don't feel like that you are there for me. I stop myself and say, God is never a do-nothing God. I'm gonna take this unknown, and instead of making assumptions, I'm gonna fill this space with grace and prayer.
Yeah, that's so good. And I love how you talk about, even though we're seeing beautiful or we're trying to see beautiful, there definitely is an element of the unseen work of God in that. And so I love that phrase, God is not a do-nothing God. That's one of my favorites. So one of the devotionals in Seeing Beautiful Again talks about how we can hold both sorrow and celebration in both of our hands at the same time. Can you tell me a little bit about what that means?
Sometimes I think we're in seasons where we define it as, this is a season of sorrow, this is a season of celebration. And we kind of think we have to choose one or the other. But what God has really been teaching me is our days, our experiences, our situations, our seasons can be both and. They can be both a season of sorrow and a season of celebration, and they can coexist together. And one thing that I wrote about in the book was, you know, sometimes when we go through hard times and maybe we've had a relationship that disintegrated, and then we're walking through our house and we see a picture of that person. And it could be a best friend. It could be a romantic relationship that fell apart. It could even be a marriage that fell apart. It can be so many different things. And so it used to be that we would see this picture of this person. It would be like, oh man, look at this fun time we had. But if the relationship disintegrates or that person walks away, we can look at that picture and just feel like, okay, that's no longer a picture of celebration, that's a picture of sorrow. It can almost feel like our pain of today needs to go back and rewrite the history of yesterday.
And it stings.
And it stings and it hurts. Yeah. And then we don't know what to do with these pictures. So what I'm a big advocate for is, your memories are your memories. And if it was a season of celebration then, you can still enjoy the celebration and you don't have to go back and tear up the picture. It's your choice. If you want to put the picture away, then put the picture away. But if that picture meant something good and beautiful to you, leave it there because you get to choose what you do with your memories. You don't have to let pain rewrite the memories of the past.
That's so good. And not just your memories from the past, right? It can be what's happening today.
That's right.
I could probably have multiple sorrow and celebration moments even before lunch sometimes, you know?
That's right.
And I think holding both of those at the same time, that both and perspective, it's just something that's been so freeing for me to not have to put yourself in a box as, like you said, an all sorrow season or an all celebration season.
Yeah, and how that can play out is like, you know, things, you can have a series of things that happen before 8 a.m. and you're like, this is a bad day.
Exactly.
Well, no, the day's not bad.
Right.
The situations may have not been pleasant.
Right.
But this isn't denying your feelings. However, it's realizing your feelings are indicators, not dictators. They can indicate, yes, there's some hard things I need to tend to, but they don't have to dictate today is a bad day. And you can still intentionally find beautiful, even in this day, that some hard things happened early on. Today is a gift, and that's what God says. And so we just need to approach it as if I'm going to look for the gift of today.
Yeah, that's so good. I love that. So we've talked a lot about ourselves maybe being in hard or hurtful situations, but let's shift a little bit to talking about maybe a friend that's in a really hard season or a heartbreaking season or just going through some devastation. So is there a way that we can actually bring beautiful into their lives or help them see beautiful? Or maybe you could share a memory or something that someone did for you that really helped you see beautiful when you were in that really hard place.
I would say one of the best things that someone did for me when I was in a really hard place is they chose to listen and restrain from giving advice.
Wow.
Now, if I ask for their advice, then that's one thing. But sometimes the greatest gift of beautiful you can give to somebody is to listen, and then when they share hard things, just to look at them and say, I believe you. And maybe even then ask them, say, hey, what is something that would make your day a little brighter, mm-hmm. a little more beautiful today? Now, they're probably not going to say like, oh, if you brought me flowers, you know,
yeah.
because that can feel a little presumptuous.
Right.
But you can ask the question like, hey, what I sent a text message to a friend just today. Mm-hmm. She's going through some surgery
yeah.
on Friday. And I asked her, okay, if someone was going to do something kind for
right.
you, would you rather have chocolate, flowers, or what was the last one? Or like a massage certificate, like
uh-huh.
gift certificate to go do something
yeah.
like massage or manicure,
like
pedicure,
spa,
whatever.
Yeah.
And of course she said, oh no, you don't have to do anything. And I'm like, okay, you're right, I don't. But if someone
if I were going to do that. Right.
And so it gave her an opportunity to say, wow, chocolate, that's the best way to love
so
on
sweet.
Me. And so I think, again, listen with intentionality. Mm-hmm. Don't always feel the pressure that you have to solve their problems or
yeah.
give them the ultimate advice, because sometimes a great thing you can do for somebody is just to say, I believe you.
Yeah, another thing that you've said before is having a friend that will pray more words for you than they're speaking to you or about you. And I think that goes hand in hand with the listening ear.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I love that. That's so good. Okay, so when so many of us are going through a hard time, and with this being a devotional, so it's kind of like a tool for daily time with God, when you're in a really hard season, it can feel so tiresome or really just challenging to get into God's word at all. And so if someone is in that place today, what would you say to them, maybe about this devotional or just in general, how can we get into God's word when we're just in that really tough spot?
I would say give yourself permission to make this a one or two verse a day.
Yeah.
And sometimes I'll just take a verse
mm-hmm.
and I'll even just take a couple of words of that verse and I'll let my mind park there. And I just always ask myself the question, am I reading this or am I letting this read me? Because I kind of want both.
Yeah.
I want to read God's word, but then I want God's word to read me. But don't feel like you have to do deep study of a whole chapter of a Bible today. If you can, that's
mm-hmm.
amazing.
Yeah.
But if you're feeling worn thin, I think it's better to choose one verse than no verse.
Yeah, that's so good. And you're a Bible teacher, so to hear you say that makes me feel like I can do that too. That's really great. I love that. Okay, so last question. I'd love for you to camp out in this for a little bit and give us some practical ways that maybe this has colored your world. But when nothing feels beautiful inside of us or around us at all, whether that is our circumstances or maybe we're struggling with mental health or we have a relationship that's causing a lot of grief in our life, what are some ways that we can actually experience or cultivate beauty in our life? Or maybe what are some ways that you're experiencing beauty right now all around you in unexpected ways?
It's a great question. So I have decided to give myself permission
okay.
to explore some of the arts
yeah.
that I haven't done since a very long time, you
yeah.
know? And so just last week we got together
yeah, we painted.
And you and I painted
mm-hmm.
together. If you read my book, It's Not Supposed to Be This Way, you know, painting became such a beautiful expression. And it wasn't about the quality of art. It
right.
wasn't about creating fine art. It
yeah.
wasn't even about, you know, like taking the piece, framing it, and putting it up in my house. But what I always do when I create some painting or drawing, and y'all, I'm not like a talented artist or anything
like
that.
You're pretty good, I don't know.
But I always tell myself, Lysa, the true beauty in this is sending it to someone else
wow.
and allowing them to experience a blessing from the beauty that you've created
mm-hmm.
and not to be so intimidated that if it's not perfect or it doesn't look like a certain standard of quality or whatever. And it's so funny, when we painted last week, I sent the just a picture really quick to a friend whose birthday was that day
mm-hmm.
and I said, I painted this, and while I was painting it, I thought of you.
Wow.
And she said, this is so incredibly
so
special.
Sweet.
And it wasn't because it was a masterpiece. It was because of the intentionality. And that's really what brings us full circle
yeah.
and seeing beautiful again, is just get intentional about doing things that not only make you feel like you are adding to the beauty of this world, but also get intentional with the perspectives that you have. Beauty is in the eye of the beholder.
Yeah.
And so if you choose to see beautiful, you will.
Yeah, I love that. And I've heard, we've talked about this before, but whatever you're seeking or whatever you're looking for, if you're looking for God, you'll find him. If you're looking for love, you will find it because you're looking for it intentionally, like you're saying. And so, friend, wherever you're tuning in from today, I hope that this Q&A with Lysa blessed you. And whether you are experiencing that heartbreaking season where you're in right now and you needed to hear, it's okay if you just need one or two verses to cling to today. That is enough for getting into God's word. Or maybe you have a friend, like Lysa was talking about, that's walking through a really heartbreaking season and you've been struggling to figure out how to be a loving friend to them during this time. I hope and pray that our conversation blessed you today. And I also want to encourage you, grab your copy of Seeing Beautiful Again. It's 50 devotions to find redemption in every part of your story. And I think it's my favorite book that you've put together yet, Lysa. Thanks for your time today.
Yeah, thank you, Shae. Appreciate it.